name is Martin Zietsman. I'm 32 years old, currently living in Stellenbosch in the Western Cape, South Africa. And it's always been a lifelong dream of mine since I was a kid to be a professional mountain bike racer. I spent my high school years growing up in the UK, and for the duration that I was there, I spent my time riding downhill, dirt jumping, four cross, pretty much anything that I could just to be on my bike. Riding was my life, it was my passion. Nothing brought me as much joy or ever has as the simple pleasure of riding a mountain bike. I failed high school, and at the age of 25, I decided that it was time to make something of my life, that my results at high school were not going to define me and hold me back, and that I was worth more than that. And I decided to start pursuing the goal and the dream of becoming an engineer. An incredible amount of hard work and dedication saw me eventually ending up studying at Stellenbosch, and finally graduated this year with my bachelor's degree in mechatronic engineering. When I actually got enrolled to Stellenbosch University, that's when I realized that if someone who failed high school can get accepted to the top engineering faculty in the country, that pretty much anything is possible if you really badly want it enough and you're willing to put in the hard work. And that's what prompted me to start racing again and to actually start pursuing my original childhood dream of becoming a pro mountain biker. When I first started cycling again, my goal was to race cross-country World Cups. And I was fortunate enough to enlist the help of Dr. Jeroen Swart with my coaching. He's highly regarded as the top endurance and cross-country coach in the country. And he's helped to take my riding to a whole other level. I've spent the last 3 years working very hard at my riding with Jeroen at the same time as completing my degree. And now that I've actually completed it, I'm ready to take both my cycling and my professional career to the next level. By the time you're hearing this, I will already have packed up and sold up my whole life, and I'll be headed to the airport on my way to the UK. So for the 2017 racing season, I'll be focusing on the full British Enduro Series, a number of the Scottish Enduro Series, and hopefully at least four of the Enduro World Series. That's dependent on me actually getting entries for the races. For many years I've believed that there will always be someone more talented than me and more capable than me, but there's no reason for them working harder than me. And I want to show the younger generations that if they take on that same motto, that they can achieve anything with their lives.
Good evening, folks. Welcome to Pin TV Live from Albert's Shed in Shrewsbury, brought to you by Muck Off. And tonight we have a special guest, myself, Jim, Stu over there, Doc at the helm behind all the controls, and Martin, if you want to introduce yourself.
Hey everyone, I'm Martin Zietsman. I'm originally from South Africa and living here in the UK. Honoured to be joining these boys tonight on the live show.
Excellent. Stu, do you want to start it off?
All right, do you want me to start it off?
You might as well, aren't you?
All right, what, start with the interview?
Yeah, go on.
Well, we'll get back in there.
Get straight in there.
So, whereabouts are you from in SA? That's South Africa for anyone that doesn't know. We're going to be doing that a lot.
Yeah,
otherwise we'll
it's a mouthful, isn't it?
It's a mouthful.
Right, so I was living in Cape Town before I moved here. Studied there the last few years. And then really wanted to come to the UK to race, so I took a job over here.
And to stay alive.
And yeah, I got sick of chasing my tea every night, you know.
Brilliant. So you like your biking, when did it start? When did you start riding bikes, BMX or whatever you did?
Yeah, I actually started, grew up a large part of my life here in the UK.
Yeah.
Went to school in Leeds and got into downhill way back in 99.
So what years were you in the UK first time?
From 99 to 2007, so it was just under 9 years.
Yeah.
Just under 9 years that I was here.
Right.
Yeah, so I finished high school, worked a few years, raced for quite a few years, and then headed back to South Africa.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Brilliant.
But broke myself pretty badly riding downhill and dirt jumping, so ended up quitting in 2005, and then got back into it in 2012, so it was a really big gap of no riding.
Having that big gap sometimes, I mean, it makes you more hungry though, doesn't it?
Yeah. Well, when I started again, I mean, when I rode when I was a kid, the dream was always to be pro. I mean, I grew up watching you guys on Sprung videos and all the races and reading your articles in Dirt magazine. So that was always the dream. And when I started riding again, I was like, well, you know what? I might as well give it a proper shot this time.
Yeah.
Actually put some effort into racing. Yeah.
So what did you do to yourself when you broke yourself?
Oh, well, when I quit, that was the third big break, and I ended up breaking my left ankle, broke my ankle ball off, had plates in, did all the ligaments, dislocated it. Yeah, it was a pretty bad one. Yeah, that was the third big break, and I don't know, I just didn't have the confidence to get back on a bike again and ride the way that I was.
Crikey.
It can knock you a bit, something like that, can't it? Really put you back. So,
it was the third one in about three or four years, and they just kept getting progressively worse, and I was just at the point where I couldn't take time off work anymore and all of that.
So who were your early riding influences?
Obviously, like I said, I grew up watching you guys racing on the scene and stuff like, you know, Neil Donoghue, Rob Jarman and all of that. But obviously my biggest influence was Greg Minnaar.
Yeah.
I watched him race his first ever race.
It would have to be, wouldn't it?
Come on, he's the greatest of all time and he's South African, you know.
Yeah.
Watching him dominate on the world circuit, it makes me very proud too.
Yeah.
So I watched him race his first race in the UK way back in about 2000 at Peterbridge.
That was when he was on Global Orange.
Yeah.
We were at that race, weren't we?
Yeah, we were at that. Yeah,
I actually remember Donny in Elethan. There was a national, I think it was a four cross race there.
All right.
And I remember Donny saying, oh, it looks like Greg Minnaar, the junior world champion. And like at the time, I was just like, what? I thought he was taking a mickey.
Yeah.
I thought, what's the South African doing in an Elethan? Put my teeth in a minute. I'm having a stroke, am I?
Martin might be stroking you.
In Elethan.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I didn't know anything about him, and obviously we saw him ride and realised that this kid's going to be something pretty special.
Yeah.
Because he did 2 years in the UK, didn't he?
I think he did quite a while, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I'd never heard of him until I saw him at Peterbridge, and when I heard that there was a South African on the hill, and I think he either won or he came second that day.
Mm.
And yeah, that feeling, I remember going up to him and saying, you know, you've really done South Africa proud, you know.
And that's what
really felt good to me. So ever since then, followed his career and his progress.
Well, we knew him pretty well, and we kind of followed him for all those years. I remember in the early days, he was remember the four cross and stuff? He was always the one that was just great at jumping.
Yeah.
Something needed to be jumped. He was brilliant.
That was his motocross, early influences, wasn't it?
The whips that he used to throw, I remember that from all the videos, and he used to pull a couple of tricks that were kind of signature to Greg back in the day. Some no-hander variations and stuff, I remember that well, yeah.
What sort of a star is he in
South Africa, yeah. We're going to work on that yet. It's actually a bit sad because, I mean, he's regarded as one of the greatest mountain bikers of all time, but in South Africa in general, he's not very well known. Obviously, in the cycling circles, everyone knows who he is. But in general, in general public, he's not that well known. But I think that's that's kind of an international problem, really, isn't it? The mountain biking doesn't quite get the exposure.
It's a shame, isn't it? Because you go to an event like World Cup or EWS or something like that, and you just think, you know, it's easy to look at people, God, these are legends of their time, proper heroes, yet outside that small zone, which when you're in it seems big. I mean, for anybody that's sort of seen a video, a drone over the top of a race village, it doesn't look that big, does it?
No, no.
So outside that zone, really, our sport is just this big.
Yeah.
So.
And it's actually, it is a very exciting sport. I mean, it requires incredible skill and dedication. Mm. So, you know, it kind of feels like it's not getting the reward that it should. Yeah.
So tell us, I think, the way I thought, and I'm guessing how a lot of other people would be thinking, is you'd think South Africa, incredible scenery, big mountains. So you'd think, right, mountain biking must be massive over there, must be so many places to ride, loads of clubs, blah, blah, blah. Yet you come over here to race. So what's the differences? Why is that?
Well, we definitely have got a massive mountain biking scene in South Africa. And I stand under correction, but I believe that the mountain biking has actually overtaken golf as the official corporate sport in South Africa. So mountain biking is huge, but it's the main sport there is cross country and marathon and stage racing, whereas gravity is actually a very small discipline. We've got amazing trails and trail networks. I mean, where I lived in Cape Town was one of the best mountain biking spots in the world. I mean, the top cross country guys, Nino Schurter and the Bulls guys, have all their training camps there. But in terms of gravity, downhill and enduro, it's still pretty small. And
why do you think that is?
I just think because of, I'm not actually sure, to be honest. I think the marathon scene is so big, to try and all the trails are catered towards that, so it's difficult to grow a sport when all the money's in a different area. Whereas I think the UK, you're very fortunate that through the years, especially with Steve Pete and stuff, gravity has become such a focus of cycling over here. You kind of, it's built it up to something very impressive, and I'm impressed at every race I go to how big it is here.
Do you think, go on, Steve, sorry.
Well, I was just going to say, it's not to say that in the UK, obviously downhill's been around for well over 20 years now, and when we first got into it, it did become very big, didn't it? It was massive, and then obviously it's had its problems over the last sort of 10 years where it has faded out. But enduro, without a doubt, has made downhill big again.
Yeah,
the enduro mountain bike thing has just made it so expansive and expensive.
Yeah,
somebody that may not want to ride downhill say, "Well, I could go and do enduro," and then they get a bit good and they say, "Actually, I wouldn't mind doing a downhill race."
Yeah.
So it's just bringing everybody back to it.
It's
so
kind of making
it
a lot
favor.
More accessible.
Yeah.
As well.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Because I mean, the trail bikes, the enduro bikes of today. I mean, we did a cross-country ride on it essentially this weekend, and then you can still hit pretty much most of the downhill tracks.
We've had that conversation loads of times.
Yeah.
You think of the enduro bikes now that we race enduro on are like 10 times better than any downhill bike we rode 20 years ago.
I think my current enduro bike has got more travel than my downhill bike 10, 15 years ago.
Well, I remember 2002, I gave up downhill. I was doing the Dirt magazine thing and had a good ride, and it was almost, those days it was almost every weekend in the summer we were racing, weren't we? And I just had enough of it. And I remember one day on my way to race, I've had enough of this, and I didn't ride pretty much for 10 years. But I was thinking about that when we were riding, you know, and you're going up the hill and you're like blowing out your arse because you're trying to keep up with a 6'5" South African. And I was thinking about it, I thought, I reckon the reason I give up was because back in those days, you didn't do cross country. Well, we did. As a downhiller, you had a downhill bike and you had a jump bike, and you didn't do big rides on the jump bike.
Yeah.
So if you've had enough of downhill, then it's a bit like, well, I don't want to do cross country. So we just did something else, motorbikes and stuff. Whereas now it's just loads more interesting, isn't it?
It wasn't really trail bikes back then either, was there?
No.
So, there wasn't that happy medium in between.
No, that's right.
Yeah.
I think this next one's for you to explain.
Yes. So, we've been working on the accent. It's quite a difficult accent to do.
I don't think we've been working hard enough.
No. Yeah.
But I just got to say that Martin did say there's quite a few people out there from South Africa.
Yeah, sorry.
So at this point, I'm going to have to apologise for my partner in crime over there.
Yeah, yeah.
I'll leave you to it.
And back in my younger days, I did do a bit of travelling and stuff with some South Africans. And obviously I know a bit, you've got like your English ones and you've got your Afrikaans and you're half, aren't you? Is it your dad's Afrikaans?
That's correct, yeah.
Why, I mean, you're 6'5" and the thing that strikes me about every Afrikaans bloke I've ever met is them, why are they so massive?
I've got no
idea.
They're
beasts, aren't they?
They are big, yeah. The Afrikaans in South Africa are generally, well, especially from years gone by, were farmers.
Yeah.
Yeah, and right. The farmers, they're tough, hard yeah. people back home, yeah.
That's a bit like Shropshire, isn't it? The old saying was, it Shropshire born, Shropshire bred. Strong in the arm, thick in the head.
Yeah.
I'm from Staffordshire, by the way. You can say that.
I'm from Shropshire.
So the Afrikaans, just a little bit of geography for you guys. They're originally Dutch, is that correct?
That's correct,
so
yeah.
You can talk Dutch to Dutch people. Is that your first language?
That's my second language, but it's as good as my first language because yeah. I speak both just about as fluently. Dutch is slightly different, so when like, I communicate with a Dutchman or a Dutch person, it's got to be slow.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
if I'm listening to two Dutch people talking, I won't follow most of it because they talk too fast.
Bit like us listening to someone from Glasgow.
That's like, yeah.
So for instance, what would be a, let's think of a sentence in Afrikaans. Say you were going to say, do you want to go riding some enduro tomorrow with us? How would you say that? We've got to say this, Stu, by the way.
You're going to be practicing this.
Yeah.
Okay. Wil jylle môre 'n bietjie fiets gaan ry?
Wil jylle môre 'n bietjie fiets gaan ry?
That wasn't too bad, actually.
I heard Bicky. I've forgotten
what that sounded like, so I'm going to pass.
Go on, you got to have another go. Say it again.
I'll say it slower. Wil jylle bietjie môre fiets gaan ry?
Wil jylle bietjie
môre?
Môre
fiets gaan ry.
Fits on the way.
There you go.
Awesome.
Perfect. Perfect.
Well, they train now.
That's it.
Right, that's it. We're going to get you guys over to South Africa now.
Really from South Africa now.
Yeah. South. And what's it? Oh, we've got to get you. I mean,
this is Jim's favourite.
Yeah,
come in.
There's a few words.
Yeah, okay.
I'm a massive Steve Coogan, Alan Partridge fan, and one of the old Alan Partridge episodes is he keeps getting his South African mate to say pyrotechnic. So you got to go in your deepest South African accent.
My deepest Afrikaans kind of accent.
Yeah.
Pyrotechnics.
And brown bread, no, white bread, brown bread, that's the other one.
Oh yeah, the Steve Pete Syndicate boys are going to love this because they keep hammering me about
yeah.
this. Yeah. White bread, brown bread.
White bread, brown bread. Brilliant.
I think at this point, let's be early.
We're going to be early.
Yeah,
on the,
you're 3 seconds early.
Sacks,
now you're late.
Underwear, crash of the week. What have we got, Doc?
Right, this was sent in by Matty Upton, and it
yep.
really is why you shouldn't use vapes when you're going down slams.
He's happy there.
It's going to be up on my lap in a second.
So we'll see this in a minute, as
Ten
we tell
minutes.
All the guests, with a massive delay. Come on in. Oh. I think we did. I put out something on Facebook today. Can you send us a crash video? Because we haven't got any, and we are absolutely inundated with them.
Oh, really?
So the way we chose them basically was we went with the first one. The easiest way of doing it. So
we still
see
can't
this.
See it, but we can only assume that Jamie's had a crash.
That's now back at you guys.
Right. Okay.
It should come up on your screen in a second.
So I'll have a look through the comments.
Yes. Go on. Oh, here we go. We're coming up. Sorry to be talking to you about something you've already seen. So he will get his free pair of Saks underwears, boxers from, oh my god, that went wrong right from the start. Shouldn't have touched that back brake, son.
Yeah, I think that one tickled a bit, didn't it?
Yeah. So,
he has earned a pair of knickers, though.
Get in touch. Get in touch and you'll get your free pair of Saks underwear.
Do you want to carry on, Jim? And
I'll carry on while you have a little look.
See what abuse we're getting.
So, what do you miss the most from South Africa?
Oh, there's so much. I want to say the sunshine and the heat, but we've had a pretty good summer so far.
Yeah.
Well, I've been sat on the sofa for most of it, watching the summer go by.
Yeah,
but,
yeah.
I think the people and my friends back home.
Yeah.
Yeah, I miss that a lot. And the riding, the really, really fast, open, dusty trails.
Right,
yeah.
Yeah,
miss that quite a lot.
And your dogs?
And my dogs, yeah. Yeah, but they're at my dad's house, which is yeah, South Africa's a big place, so that was quite far away from
us. That's a word I can't say as well, is those type of dogs, and hardly anyone's even ever heard of them over here, but my friend's dad's got one, and I'd call it a boa bowl, but what's the proper way of saying it?
A burble.
Burble. So he's got burbles.
Yeah.
And these dogs, you've got to check them out. It's spelt B-O-E-R,
B-O-E-L.
B-O-E-L. Check them, just Google one and have a look. They're all like monsters, aren't they?
Yeah, our one big one, his head used to be like literally that. Yeah. It was a monster.
Just like Ian, but I think Ian would just destroy them.
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
It's
a raging machine.
Yeah. I've got to say, Stu, he stayed at my house this weekend and we've been riding, which we'll talk about in a bit. But saying about what you miss in South Africa, and what I've noticed with South, not just yourself, but a lot of South Africans I've met, including Greg Minot, is I think they're the most respectful people I've ever met. And like their manners and everything, it's like absolutely tip top. Is there a reason for that, do you think? Is it just your upbringing or?
Yeah, we actually chatted about this weekend, didn't we?
Yeah.
That you definitely see, especially in the Afrikaans culture in South Africa, is respect. Yeah.
Yeah.
Especially because like you said, the guys are so big. If you're disrespectful, you get a clip on the back of the head. So you kind of have to be. Yeah. It's actually weird. It's in South Africa, it's very disrespectful to call someone who's older than you by their first name. You actually have to. Like as a salutation, calling them uncle or aunt before you say their first name. So yeah,
remember
respect
that,
is.
Yeah. Uncle
Jim.
Uncle
Jim.
So,
I actually had a bit of a thing with. I'll start that again. Two Afrikaans.
Yeah, you definitely need to rephrase that.
Right, okay. I went on holiday to Dubai and I like playing a bit of golf, and I just went down the local golf club. It was quite a big one, posh. And the guy said, oh, yeah, any of these two chaps will, you know, they'll play golf with you.
Yeah, play with you.
Yeah. And these two guys turned up when I met them, and they were, from South Africa, massive guys. So already I'm thinking, well, this ain't going to go well. We stand on the first tee, and these two guys say, so we're going to have a bet on this, in South African accent, obviously, 15,000 dirhams, or whatever it was. I think that's what it was in Dubai at the time. So I'm stood there with these two guys, and I've just got myself into a bet, but it actually turned out that amount of money is about 15 quid.
So
that was quite a worrying 18 holes, but I actually won.
Oh,
so I made 15 quid. That's it.
Have we got any messages, Jim?
We've got a lot of people saying hello. There's a bit of banter going on between Smiley and Doc.
Yeah.
Love there.
Yeah.
Just people checking in, really.
Lewis Bradley's asked a question.
Yeah.
Martin, have you ever done the Cape Epic?
No, I haven't actually. That's definitely one that's on my list. The last few years I've been studying, so I wasn't able to do it. Always coincided with exams. And the entry fee is quite ridiculous for that if you want to try and do it as a privateer. So no, I haven't, but I definitely want to.
It's on my list.
Yeah.
Well, I sold that first intense I had, I sold that to a guy who was going to do the Cape Epic on it. From the Isle of Man. Bit weird, isn't it?
Yeah.
Random. Bit of random. Okay.
Titan 46 says, I work with a huge South African who has a Yorkshire accent. Martin might know who I'm speaking of.
Who is that?
I'm not sure.
It's probably someone who works with me, and he's referring to my brother, who is pretty damn huge, yeah.
Yeah.
Does he speak with
a Yorkshire accent?
Yes, he does.
Could be.
Talking of job, do you want to explain to people what you do?
Yeah, so like I said, I graduated last year. I studied something called mechatronic engineering, and I work for a really cool company called Bilstein. We've actually got a book that we're going to be giving away as a prize later, so I think everyone will recognize that logo. So I design dampers for them. Yeah, so I'm a design engineer working special projects, so I do all sorts of really cool projects.
So you don't send your shocks and things off to be serviced, do you do them yourself?
Well, I've not needed to yet, but I would be able to, yeah.
Yeah, brilliant.
Yeah.
So, tell us about the deal. Tell us about, what you're on riding and etc.
Sponsors and products and stuff?
Yes.
Yeah, so, yeah, I'm really, really fortunate to have some awesome brands supporting me. You can see my bike behind us here. It's the Nolly Warden Carbon, in size extra small, obviously.
Yeah.
So that's one of my big sponsors. Obviously, I'm wearing the Liat kit here. I think a lot of people don't know they're a South African brand.
I didn't know that till you told me.
Yeah, so the Liat neck brace originated from South Africa. So I'm really, really fortunate to be riding for them. They give me all my support with clothing, kit protection, helmets, all of that. Maxxis tyres are a really big help for me. The guys in South Africa and the UK help me out, so depending on which country I'm in. And then a couple of other brands, MRP, yeah. They do my forks. So I'm running the new Ribbon fork, which is a boost fork, and it runs the ram control cartridge in, which is getting quite a lot of hype at the moment.
Very clever fork, that is, isn't it?
Yeah, it's I'm enjoying it, although that fork is brand new. And we've not got to that section yet, but I injured, broke my wrist, so I've not been able to set it up properly yet because I haven't got the strength to compress it yet. Mm. So I'm a bit bummed about that.
Yeah, I think it's a good time actually to say we met at the Hard Rock the other week, didn't we? Which is probably the worst place in the UK you could go for a knackered wrist.
Yeah.
That was my first ride back on the mountain bike as well. Yeah. So yeah, that was quite an experience trying to hang on down there.
We were talking at the top of the last stage, and you were like, "Oh, my wrist's not so good." And it was rough as a bear's down there, so you got down, which is pretty.
You must have done some gritting of teeth there.
Yeah, and I spent a lot of time sitting down on that stage because I just couldn't handle the knocking and stuff. So yeah.
Tell us about your injury then, what you did.
Yeah, so racing at UK Champs in April. I was stage one at Graithwaite.
Yeah.
And it was a pretty gnarly route that.
Yeah.
And yeah, I've been going pretty hard. I was there obviously with the goal of winning with the weekend. Yeah, and it was actually a really easy section on track. I better conserve some energy. It was a really technical section coming up. And I just came down a chute, easy chute into a flat section. And I just like relaxed my grip for a second. Front wheel caught a root or something, blew my hand off the bar and I went straight into a tree.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I crushed my wrist between my chest and the tree. And yeah, I've only been back on the bike less than a month now.
So did you snap the bone or?
Yeah, so. Completely broke off the ulna, I believe. So right where it reaches the wrist, I completely broke it off there. So I panicked pretty bad when it first happened because that whole shard kind of like shifted and it looked like I'd completely like broke my arm in half. And yeah, so I've got a screw in there to put it all back together and I'm still recovering my muscles. You can see I've got very limited movement on it and stuff, so still very weak and very frustrating.
On the mend though?
Yeah, on the mend. The riding's actually doing it really good. I was really struggling before Hard Rock, and that weekend I probably saw the biggest jump in improvement and strength in my wrist just from pushing it through that.
Yeah. Tell us about your best results then.
Best results this year in the UK. Second overall in Masters category at the Welsh Gravity Enduro Series.
Pretty good.
Yeah, I was really stoked with that. I managed a second at Eastridge.
Yeah.
Is it Andy Woodvine?
Yeah, Woody, local legend.
Yeah, beat me by 0.05 seconds.
And
close.
He can write a book on that place as well. He
knows
every
rock,
every bump.
Not taking anything away from him.
That was a close race though. Yeah. So that was good. I enjoyed when it's that close, you're gunning it right to the finish line.
Yeah.
Managed a second or a third, I can't remember now, at Pitficky at the Scottish Enduro Series.
Yeah.
Really stoked with that one. I ripped my mech off and got a puncture there, so to walk away with a second, I was really stoked.
That's the POC series, isn't it?
Yeah.
That's their real rough,
proper
downhills, aren't they, those sections?
Yeah,
I think
stage one was on the downhill track that they used for the SDAs. Mm. I think I won that stage, so I was really stoked with that. And
so you got the hang of the UK ride in a bit then?
Yeah, well that was a dry one, so that worked in my favour. Yeah. Fort William, first round of the POC series. I think I came eighth there, but I won three stages. So those were the kind of bike parky stages, the trail centre, and then the mud stages, I was just nowhere. I was tripodding and scooting down there.
Yeah, okay. Well, I'm going to interrupt the interview for a minute. I want to get back in a minute and talk a little bit more about the bike and your components, some real interesting stuff on there.
Yeah.
But it's 8 o'clock, so it's time for the Trailhead Photo of the Week. We got Doc, which we'll see at about 8:05.
Well,
yeah.
This has been sent in by Andrew Phillips, or the Boy Panda, and it's up at Hard Rock. So, and this guy is, I can't remember how old Andrew said he was.
63.
63, and he's keeping it pinned. Nice photo, Andrew. Really good dude.
We'll see that in a minute, but while we're looking, I can see some comments. Joel Williams, Martin, everyone in Cape Town says, how's it?
How's it, guys?
How's it?
Glad to see some local boys, local guys watching.
Rick Ellis, great to see Martin back. P.S. I love Doc.
I met Rick in Scotland, I believe, at Tweedlove.
Yeah, he's a good bloke, he is.
Really nice
fast
guy.
As well.
Yeah, quick as well.
Yeah, we've been riding together for a while.
Simon Smith, how did Mart like Ardrock?
I was so gutted that I couldn't race it. Those were some of the best trails I think I've ever seen. It was suited a lot to the kind of stuff I'm used to in South Africa, really fast, and I love racing blind. So
yeah.
I was really, really gutted I couldn't race that. I'll be back next year for that one.
Yeah,
definitely. Ace.
Yeah.
So we've done that, we've done the photo. I want to get back to talking about your bike because you've got some, I mean, you've got the forks, the MRP forks, which are rare as anything.
Yeah, there's quite a few rare parts on this unit.
Yeah, and the gearing's what interests me. You're using the box gears, aren't you?
Box drivetrain, yeah. So I was really fortunate. The importers in South Africa who actually import most of the components on this bike, so Nolly and MRP, they're the importers for box components. So
yeah.
Managed to get that on the bike. And I know a lot of people were worried about that shifter with the one lever push.
Yeah.
I got used to it immediately and I'm really enjoying it, yeah.
Right.
Yeah, so.
Good support off those guys?
Yeah, actually really good. I came over here, had one or two issues, and I got hold of the British distributors to try help me out, and they were straight on the ball. So yeah, I'm really stoked with that, and I'm looking forward to been helping a bit with testing and development on that, so I'm hoping to continue working with them.
And riding with you at the weekend, the noise too from those hubs, oh my god, they're the nicest sounding hubs.
Oh, those
spin?
Industry Nines.
Will you hear a spin? Is it the right? No, that way. Go on.
Listen to that. Nice. Yeah, Industry Nine, and you've got the South African carbon hand-built rims as well. Do you want to say a bit about them?
Yeah, South Industries. Say hi to Nico and Stefan, they're in Cape Town.
Stefan,
yeah.
Right, Stefan.
Yeah, so the rims are actually really cool. They're properly handmade in South Africa, laced up, and the carbon lay work is done there in Cape Town. So it's not like imported and they put their own stickers on.
Yeah.
So they actually do the layups there, and I've been involved all last year with testing and development on that. I raced an EWS with them last year, did Trans-Provence with them. So yeah, and they're really kind. They do a nice little custom touch with my name on the decals.
Cool, yeah,
so that's really a really nice touch that they do there. So yeah.
And you, talking about development, you're involved with the, you say it Liat or is it
Liat?
Liat,
yeah.
So you're involved in developing that stuff as well, aren't you?
Yeah. Fortunately, because it's a South African brand and their head office is in Cape Town, that's how I got into the company. So yeah, I get involved with a lot of testing and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
They send me products and I give them feedback. And yeah, so there's some really, really cool stuff coming for next year.
We were looking, weren't we, Stuart, at Core Bike Show.
in Core Harrow, and we thought it was really cool looking stuff, actually.
Yeah.
Particularly the helmets.
And this weekend, I was looking real close at all this kit, and I was amazed, little
hopefully
touches
not
on
too
it.
Close.
Oh, wow, yeah. Couple of, so, for instance, I just want to mention a few things that caught my eye.
Besides his arse.
Yeah. So that race top was like really, really aerated, so you were nice and cool.
Yeah.
And you got this pocket here for your goggles.
Yeah.
Zip pocket
Should
for your goggles.
One there?
Let's have a look at one. Let's grab that quickly.
And then behind the zip pocket, you've got this sort of cleaning cloth inside it for
That's
your goggles.
Idea.
I actually brought some kit with because I knew you were going to talk about this.
Yeah.
Right, so this is actually more the winter top, so it's not the super aerated one. But that's the pocket you were talking about.
Yeah.
For your goggles, you've even got a little goggle sign there. And on the inside, the pad for cleaning.
That's a good idea.
Cleaning
that's
your glasses and
really
stuff,
good
yeah.
Idea.
Has that got the rubber bit on for your shorts?
On the inside, you've got a little rubber strip there. And that actually, on their shorts, they've also got a rubber strip on the back. And that's to prevent the tops from pulling up when you're pedaling and stuff.
It looks really simple.
I looked at that and I thought, why has no one else thought? I mean, there probably is other companies that do it, but I was blown away by that.
It's really clever and it works so well because you literally don't have to like constantly keep pulling your top down and stuff.
Tons of pockets in that as well, aren't there?
Yeah, nice big pockets. You get my huge bear claws in there.
I wonder what you're going to say then. it's not Saks pants, you know. What else have I noticed? The helmet, it doesn't use MIPS, it does its own thing, doesn't it?
Yeah, they've got like a turbine system that helps to absorb the rotational forces when you're crashing, to prevent concussions and stuff.
Brilliant.
I think the other thing you were looking at was the knees on this.
Ah, that was it. They're shaped like that at the front, aren't they?
They kind of expand over the knees so that they don't get caught
that's
in your knees.
That's to reduce something that we call, we can't say it, can we? You know, when your shorts ride up over your...
Oh, the twat gap.
The twat
gap. Yeah.
The angle of the twat gap.
The angle of the twat gap.
No. Yeah. Nothing worse when you ride along and you can see skin here.
Yeah. So that's really cool. So it means that because they've got that, they can make the legs a little bit longer as well, because it's not constantly catching on the knee pads and stuff.
And the knee pads, you've got three different pairs with you, of which he's giving away a pair tonight. They're small, unfortunately. Fortunately, if they suit you, if they fit you.
Yeah.
But they are top quality. They've got holes in them. Why doesn't everyone put holes in knee pads? I spent half the day, half the ride, going uphill with my knees down by my ankle, my knees. I took my knees off, my knee pads that, and you say you can ride around in them comfortably all day without having to pull them down when it's off.
Yeah. I mean, I was doing Trans Provence last year. We were out for 8 to 10 hours a day, and I left them on my knees the whole day. So
wow.
Now there's a lot of thought going into this stuff.
Yeah.
Right. Have we got anything else here? Simon Smith, what's up, Ad? Okay. Adam NX2 MTB just subscribed to your channel, dude. Why has he just done it? He's been watching
this
for ages.
Unless he means my channel.
Oh, your channel.
Could be my channel.
No, sorry, mate. It's me being dumb there. Lewis Bradley Films, Snazzy. He's obviously on about the kit. Hey guys, it's Todd. I'm watching on a ferry. Just got back from France. That's my boy. He's been away camping for a week and I've missed him a lot. Yeah. What else have we got? Just a bit of banter between people, and that's it, really.
Final question, really, then, I guess, isn't it?
Yeah.
For this part of the interview, that is, anyway. Mm-hmm. We've got some very special ones for you after.
Yeah.
No, don't worry. So what are your future plans? Are they for the UK or are they for SA?
For now, I've agreed to another year with the company that I'm working for, Bilstein, so I'll be here at least until the end of next year. Yeah. This injury really, I had a lot of goals for this year, mm-hmm. and I've just had to scrap most of them, so I want kind of like a rerun for next year.
Yeah.
So yeah, I'm here for at least another year, I'm really glad to see that the British series is coming back, British Euro
UK
series.
UKG, yeah.
Yeah, that one, sorry, mm-hmm. yeah. Yeah, so I'm definitely going to be aiming for them, hoping to do EWS next year, because I have to cancel them all this year as well. So
it's really been a shame for you, though.
Yeah, it was just starting to all come together. I mean, I moved here in the middle of winter, essentially, so I pretty much died of the cold. And I was still out every evening training, just trying to get ready for the season.
Yeah.
And then just as the podium started coming a week before my first EWS and the injury hit, so yeah. I'm definitely trying to get back to strength and working really hard at the moment, and the plan is to try and race Elite next year, so we'll see if I can get myself up and ready
definitely
for that.
Definitely hope that you get there.
Thank you.
What we've seen and heard so far, I'm sure you won't struggle.
Yeah, exactly. So, 8:10, it's time for our used and abused product tested. This is the Renthal Fat Bar Carbon with the apex stem. I haven't got it on me, but Doc should hopefully show the video now. Stu and I are both kind of been advocates of the Renthal stuff. We've been running them for several years. Me on and off, obviously testing other stuff. So what can we say about it? The facts on the bars, you've got 10 to a 40 mil rise. 800 mil wide. These are the carbon sort of downhill bars I've been using, not the lights. 7 degree back sweep, 5 degree up sweep, 225 grams, and they come in at $139.99. The stem, 6 degree rise, or -6 if you turn it upside down. 240 degree clamping system, which I've got to be honest, I was reading that today, I still don't quite get what that means. Do you get what that means, being an engineer?
What was that, sorry?
The 240 degree clamping system.
I think that means that it's around the bar itself, it's got 240 degrees of contact.
You see, engineer. 33 to 60 mil length in the stems, depending on what you want. And the weight comes in at, depending on the length, 112 to 147 grams, and they're $89.99. Now, quite simply, my likes, they look trick. I think they look some of the best out there.
Yeah.
They do look very factory, don't they?
Mm.
You can trust the pedigree of the brand. You know you're getting good stuff with Renthal. You can't knock it. Great markings for alignment. You've got all the lines for aligning the stem and the bars up. They stand out. They do look different than all the other stuff. And the one, certainly the ones I've had, I know you don't, you've only just started using carbon bars, haven't you? You've always been an alloy bar man.
I've been using carbon bars on the enduro bike for a couple of years.
Oh, well, I didn't realise you had them on that.
But I've just started using it on the downhill bike. It's taken me a long time to kind of, I'm a bit, was a bit uneasy about carbon for downhill, but I mean, they're proven and they're strong.
And they've taken a, they've taken a lot of abuse. So my dislikes, and this is being very pinnickety, so this is tiny. I'd say they're quite pricey. They are in the high end of the price range, but also saying that, you do get what you pay for quite often. So, you know, make your own mind up there. And one thing that I have found with the Renthal stuff is creaky bolts. If every set I've had to remove the bolts, add a little bit of grease, and it fixes that problem. The creaking is gone, so I'm going to give these a rather generous 8.5 out of 10. And that's it.
And I love them.
Yeah, you do love them, don't you?
10 out of 10.
Yeah, yeah.
They are good looking,
yeah.
aren't they?
Yeah, yeah. You on about us?
Yeah.
Yeah. Do you want to start off the quick fire questions, Stu?
Why not? Pump track or dirt jumps? I know the answer to that, sure.
Dirt jumps.
Hard pack or dirt?
Hard pack because it's faster.
Downhill or enduro?
Oh, I've got to say enduro, haven't I?
You have now.
Yeah.
Flat out and scary or techie and tight?
I'm starting to really enjoy the techie and tight over here. I've always been flat out and scary.
Yeah.
So if you can combine the two, even better.
Yeah.
Yeah. Racing or riding with your mates?
Oh, that's so difficult. Racing is riding with your mates. Mm. So, yeah.
Okay. 29 or 27.5. Before you answer this, you're... Although you're 6'5", you're on a 27.5, but they haven't brought a 29 out yet, have they?
Not yet, no.
And so, if they brought a 29 out, then answer that question, 29 or 27.5?
I would go 29 because of my size.
Yeah, okay.
Just because I believe it'll be a bigger bike and I'm really running a pretty long stem.
Yeah, I was about to say, length of that stem is?
65
mil stem.
I'm going to be slaughtered at the next.
Put your arm out, put your arm out like that. Oh my god,
you have a bit more length than you have.
Your fingers start at the end of my fingers, don't they?
Yeah.
Bloody hell.
Well, got quite a wingspan.
A bloody tall lead.
Hip hop or rock?
Rock.
Tea or coffee?
Coffee all the way.
Cats or dogs?
Dogs.
Ah, fight or mediate?
Oh, make peace, not war.
And burger or healthy?
I feel like burger is healthy.
It can be healthy.
Yeah.
Depends who's made it.
Healthy
now,
burger. Yeah. Good answer. Yeah.
There you go then.
Oh, where are we? It's time to mention the channel partners, I reckon.
I think so.
We'll
start with Trailhead.
Trailhead. Mud Hugger.
V-Tire.
Bum Butter.
The Mountain Bike Adventure Portugal.
Invisiframe.
Saks Underwear.
And of course, our biggie, Muck Off. So what are we going to go on about now, what we've been up to? I think Stu has got some pretty special news. You're English now, aren't you? Proper English now, aren't you? Why are you proper English? Do you want to tell everyone?
Well, I went to the Pierce Round 5, to what we thought was just going to be Round 5 in the downhill, and it turns out that, I'm not sure the reason, but apparently it was English champs on Sunday as well.
Yeah.
And I managed to win, so apparently I'm English champ.
Well done, mate.
Yeah, well done. Did you, was it close, or in your category, were you just a fraction ahead?
I had a couple of good runs.
Yeah.
And I've got to say, actually, Crumpy's a good mate of ours. He was not that far behind me, still on a trail bike. I know he likes to mention to people, you know, well, I'm on a trail bike, you know, for a downhill, but... You know, he can get around the corners pretty quick.
We rode with him last week, didn't we? And he can still rip.
He's definitely, I mean, we won't go into it. He had a bad car crash years ago, and he was really good. You probably remember him, Mark, to be honest with you. He was like the British the first rider for GT, and we had high hopes for him. But anyway, had a car crash, blah blah blah. But this year is the first year I've seen him ride with conviction. He's back on it again, and he's bloody going quick, isn't he?
Got no confidence back again.
Yeah, well, yeah. We had a podium.
He was Mr. Smooth back in the day.
Oh, he still is. Yeah. He still is. Mm. I said to him yesterday, I said, you know, did he have any moments? He's like, nah, it was all pretty smooth. And most other people have been like, yeah, had a few moments here, there, and everywhere. Yeah. So well done to him. And I'm actually going to say another well done to another old downhill racer, Chris Derry, who managed to scrape a third yesterday. I mean, he's got plenty of skill. I think he's going to start some training now, he won't mind me saying that. But it was a proper old school podium, and we had a lot of fun. So
it looked like a lot of fun. We popped by to go have a look yesterday.
It was good. The track was great. It got beat up, it got slippy for dust reasons, not wet.
Yeah, it looked awesome.
Oh, it was brilliant. It was good, but some of the corners dead frustrating because they get blew out, and you get these little like cat litter marbles, and if you get on those, then it's curtains really. But yeah, we were talking earlier, there's a lot of people come down with the brown race kit. Must be the new style. But they were literally plastered in this dust. But yeah, great weekend. As always, Pier Cycles, just the silkiest of race series. Everything went well and it was good fun.
Fantastic. A few comments. I noticed Lewis Bradley here has said we'll be filming the course previews next Monday if anyone wants to join in. That is him going to Eastridge next Monday prior to coming on the show, because this is before the Welsh Gravity Enduro. He's one of the organisers. Where coming on the show, I think it's next week he's coming on, next Monday, they are going to be giving away a free entry to that race.
Wow, that's a good one.
Which is pretty cool.
What have you been up to then? Well, I know, but do you want to tell everyone?
I'm just going to answer this very quickly.
Oh, right.
Adam, NX2. Jim, was that Asian or a really bad South African accent? The latter, I'm afraid. That's, wasn't the best. So, we'll move on from that. Martin came over at the Hard Rock. He said he wants to ride Shropshire, and I said, come up sometime. And it ended up, because my boy's away, I was let off the leash this weekend. I was allowed to do 2 days of riding with the lads, which is amazing.
Very grateful for that.
Yes. So it came over and I took him on the sort of Shropshire, Eastridge, Stiperstones. Tried to show him the best tracks, the slightly less official ones at Eastridge, which judging by the amount of whooping and hollering behind me, I think you enjoyed them, didn't you?
Oh, I had an absolute blast. Yeah. Some awesome trails around here. It's good to ride with someone who knows the area, all the secret little trail, not the secret, but the hidden off piece stuff.
Yeah, yeah. And
then, I had a lot of fun.
And then we went up over Stiperstone, showed you the Flying Scotsman, and I think you liked the scenery as well, didn't you? It's good when you get up there.
Yeah, the views from up top are
it's well cool, isn't it?
Really, really stunning, yeah. Yeah, I really enjoyed it.
And then you stopped over, and then we went went up to Bringewood, which I haven't ridden in, we haven't been there for ages, have we?
A long time.
Which, that's awesome. They've been building up there, haven't they?
I think we were all whooping and hollering there, weren't we?
I think Bringewood is, it is classed as Shropshire, isn't it? It's Shropshire's real hidden gem.
Yeah,
Shropshire,
just
Hereford.
Talk a bit different.
Yeah, right, shag. that is a real local hidden gem, because up there all day, you don't see anyone.
Well,
and
it
the
was
trails,
until you told everyone.
Yeah, well, they wouldn't mind.
Thank you for that.
The trails are fantastic,
respect
aren't they?
Trails,
yeah.
They are wicked trails.
They are some
really,
of the best.
Really easy to pedal back up again.
And they're long as well, aren't they?
Yeah. Everywhere it's just like trail. Which one went?
Yeah.
It was so much fun.
And with Vinny as well, we'll say local star Vinny, who's trying to get back on the bike after his collarbone ready for EWS in finale. And he was, although he was slightly unfit, he didn't really look unfit, did he?
No.
But he was pulling some moves, wasn't he?
Yeah.
That boy can ride now.
Yeah, he was ripping all day. I know it's once or twice I heard him like wince a little bit from pain, so.
Yeah.
But yeah, fast.
He's just a kid, isn't he?
Yeah.
Still moans.
Yeah. So we drove them from Bringewood in the van to Hopton. Did sort of some of the loop, but as you know, we came and watched you lot.
Yeah, well, sort of.
Sort of watched. Got there, chatted to people.
Mystical.
Yeah. It turned up, that's what counted.
Well, this is it, yeah.
Yeah, someone actually, when we were there, someone went down, and I think the most of the time we were there, they had it racing held up.
Yeah, so, there was a bit of an injury.
Hoping whoever that was, you heal up soon.
Yeah.
No one likes injuries.
That was a young, one of the junior kids, wasn't it? Have you heard anything? Are they all right?
I think he's okay, yeah. They got their air ambulance out, and they thought he'd had what could have been a bad head injury, but I think he became a bit more coherent.
That's good.
And then he didn't need it, so although it was called out, brilliant that it was obviously, you know, they treated it right.
Yeah.
And you never know, especially with kids as well. Mm. I think they're more cautious, so brilliant service there, you know. Not something you want to go in, but obviously it's good to see that they do respond quickly.
Yeah.
So
did you manage to add up the K and climbing meterage that we racked up this weekend?
Yeah, I think we did about 2,100 meters of climbing the weekend, about 45 Ks.
Not bad.
Decent
I'll take
climbing,
that.
Yeah.
That's one in the bag, isn't it, really?
Yeah.
Over 6,000 feet of climbing. Sounds better, doesn't it?
Yeah.
It's quite a lot.
Was. Yeah.
Do you use feet in South Africa?
No, we use metric kilometers and kilograms. Even though we drive on the left-hand side of the road.
What about, so it, your kilograms in weight as well then?
Yeah.
What about in your height? Are you, do you just say 6'5" because you're over here?
Yeah.
So you'd be
194.
Bloody hell. Don't know what I am. A lot smaller than that.
We'd probably start shrinking now, we're getting to that age.
Yeah, I know, yeah.
Smaller
now. Apparently you're meant to do yoga and you grow again then.
Oh really?
Yeah.
I'm going to have to lay off that then.
Yeah. You're going to do the opposite of yoga. Do weightlifting. Mm. Powerlifting. Where are we at, Stu? What else has been going on? EWS.
EWS. Whistler.
Oh yeah.
I think you should tell us about this.
Definitely.
Yeah, I'm pretty gutted I wasn't there. It looked pretty mega though.
I saw some stages which were nuts.
Over 4,000 metres of climbing in one day.
Really?
Yeah, it was all in one day. I think that's
4,000
meters. Yeah, it's what, 12,000 foot.
Over 12,000 foot climb.
That's mega. Yeah, and if you look at everyone's social media feeds, everyone was saying it was like the hardest day out they've ever had. So
yeah. That's double the most I've ever done. Double it.
That's a big
a lot.
Day. The Brits did well though,
didn't they?
Yeah, Mark Scott's from Scotland in third place. Well done,
that is, that is fair play.
Yeah. Martha Gill under 21 won that one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
She's doing well, isn't she? She's got some skills. I see some of her little sort of social media videos, you know, doing the one-handed wheelie and, you know, when they grab hold of the lamppost and go round and round. I couldn't do that, could you?
No.
No.
Too old,
Yeah.
Too old to try.
I think it's not been too old. I think it's too old to have the patience to keep trying.
Yeah.
Try it once and go, I can't do that.
Can't be
arsed
with that.
Yeah.
It does get a bit like that.
Any other movers and shakers?
Sam Hill comes
again.
Second on such a mega day on flats.
It's 12,000 feet of climbing on flat paddles.
Yeah,
that's unreal,
impressive.
Isn't it?
Mm. Well down to local boy Jesse Millimet taking the win. Apparently, from the feed that I was reading, it came down to the last stage.
Really?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, so that's on a day like a big day like that, for it to come down to the last stage, that's impressive.
It's a good race that.
Yeah, and if you look at some of the video footage, those trails look really gnarly.
Yeah, that one was like really, really long, wasn't it? And it was like quite a few steep little uphills in it.
Was it like a 20-minute stage? So top of the world, I think they called it?
It looked hard, really hard. And you could see on the training video that there was a lot of, they kept going through crowds of people that just obviously stopped for a breather or in practice maybe, but I mean, that looked tough, really
it
hard.
It must be hard to race, to keep it pinned for that long on
20 minutes
stage, yeah.
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 We'd be right, because we can keep it pinned without even riding.
Easily.
That's what we do. We got a well done Stu, by the way, from 221JRB.
Well done to Josh. Josh Bennett, that is.
What
did he get in the MTH? Six. He did. Yeah, he's a up and coming star from Shropshire, isn't he? A young lad. What is he? Is he 12? 13?
13.
13.
Well done.
Brilliant little rider.
Wow.
Really
yeah.
good. Do you say he could do suicide no-handers?
Yeah.
No-handers. 13.
Right.
Stuff like that. So well done, Josh. That's really cool.
Yeah.
Do you know the women's results? Do you see who won that?
Cecile. I think it was Isabeau. Katie Winton came third.
Wow.
Yeah, well
she
done. Another Scot.
She's second or third overall now? She's got to be right up there.
So it was a Scottish third in male and female.
Yeah.
So well done, yeah.
Really good.
I saw Chris Ball, is it, the organiser?
Yeah.
He made a post last week or the week before saying, commending the POC Scottish series on such a good series because the Scots are doing so well.
In the
EAA, saying that's a sign of how a national series can actually elevate the level of the riders. So, that's a big
They
compliment.
Can ride.
Yeah.
The Scots can ride. Yeah. They're amazing, actually.
Really
I think.
Vids, aren't we coming up?
Eh?
We've got some vids coming up.
Doc's been away on holiday this week, so we haven't got anything out this week. But Wednesday is going to be our Hard Rock experience. Obviously, young Darcy, who's situated over there somewhere, he's done a couple of edits that have been put out this week, and a little edit, or sort of pre-edit of your Hopton race.
Yeah.
Top work.
It could be a good one, actually. We just mentioned that. Really, just a bit of an insight into the weekend of downhill racing, which we haven't done before.
Mm.
So it's a little story, really.
Okay,
so
cool.
That'll be good.
So the Doc will be putting together basically our edit from the weekend of Hard Rock, and we have some awesome stuff, haven't we? Looking
some
good.
Really good stuff in there. Yeah,
and
then
we got some how-tos. We've got a review of this six-man air tent. Is that Friday's one going up?
That's going up Friday. Yeah.
And a new thing we're going to do as well. We're going to be cutting out the our used and abused section from these shows, and we're going to go back to when I started them, which was probably what, 4 weeks ago.
Yeah.
And they are going to be separate little things. Films that we have on there on YouTube, because
really
shame to waste them.
Definitely.
Might as well have them if you're interested. Competition time.
It is.
What have we got?
What do you want to give away?
Well, we've got two. The one was this book, which was a pretty cool little thing that we picked up at work, which is 50 Years of Speed, Bill Stein Motorsport Story. I don't know what competition you want to run for that, but these are pretty special, actually. I'm quite jealous.
I think we should do.
I think you should just give us that. We'll have that.
Yeah. Yeah.
We'll keep
hold of
that. Thanks. Thanks for coming.
Well, I tell you what we'll do.
Why don't we do two competitions?
Yeah, we'll do two. For that one, ask him. This will literally be quick fire. Who can come up with that quickest?
Okay, first person to name the brand of my kitten protection.
Okay.
So we'll see who comes up with that one first.
Someone's put coolest dog ever about, hopefully about Ian.
Have we got a delay on this?
There's probably a delay on this. Someone here might see it earlier than us.
We do need to, yours will be quicker than the iPad, won't it? Because last week, I think we got it wrong.
No, we didn't.
No, it was right.
The lad who won last week hasn't been in touch, has he, Doc? With his address?
No, not yet.
So if you are watching, can't remember who it was. Oh, that's nearly right, but not spelt right. Oh, he spelt it right this time.
Got it second time.
So that's Adam NX2 MTB. You've got it. So Adam, that will be going out to you. Well done, mate.
Well, you can collect it.
Yeah, you can collect it, can't
he? He supports us. He comes here a bit.
So the other one.
All right, so what we've got is we're going to give it an option to whoever wins this one. So you can either have a pair of Alba pads in one of these two colours, or a knee pad.
Right.
Unfortunately, they're all in small, so these are the ones that don't fit me.
Yeah, funnily enough. They're like sort of knuckle protection for you, then.
Put one
on each finger. So, what question do you want to ask? I'd only prepared for one question.
Oh, yeah. I don't know.
Okay, shall I do one? Quick fire again.
It could be simple.
What place did Stu race at this weekend? That's nice and easy. Come up with that. Here we go. Oh, nasty language there.
Have I been rude?
Yeah, we can't say that. Not too rude.
Oh,
that's all
right. Like the gap. The gap in your knee and the shorts.
Yeah.
Got anything coming up on yours yet, Doc?
Nothing yet.
Right. Been a bit slow on this one. No, nothing coming up. What else have we got?
What hold on.
Hopton, Adam, next to So he might as well have done one competition. He's won it.
Does he wear a small?
Is it only you watching? Are you what colour do you want? Do you want the knee pad? Or what was the choice again? The knee pad?
Knee pad or elbow pad?
Or the elbow pad. And if it's elbow pad, put what colour you want? Yellow or white?
Well, if they don't fit him, they'll definitely fit his good lady.
Lewis Bradley's put, Adam's got good Wi-Fi. And he's put, come on baby, I've waited long enough. So he's obviously now, has he won before?
No, never won before.
Oh really?
Oh, he does. Yeah, he comes in, watches quite often. He always supports us, a fair play to us.
That's cool.
So just put on there, whichever, and we'll sort that out now. We don't need to be looking out for that.
We'll do a pub one.
Pub one. Have we got anything? Nothing.
I don't know.
Got
you've
got to
do a pub one.
We have got to do a pub one. Anyone have thought? I forgot about that when I wrote the show, wouldn't they? That'd never happen.
Yeah.
What have we got then? What are you going to give away? Out of your collection, Stu?
I haven't got anything. I've got some firewood and a plant, but it's not used, is it? What can we give here?
I tell you what we'll give away. We'll give away the V tyre in a tube. And some sealant to the first person in here to be able to say Martin's surname correctly.
Oh my god.
There's definitely silence in here.
Can you do it?
I can, but I'm not as alive.
Yeah, you said
no,
it.
No,
like
no,
oh no, no, it's nearly wrong. Right, it's nearly
it's
right.
Wrong.
Keep trying. No?
No.
No. No, and again, try again. How do you say Z in American?
Yeah.
Yeah. Got it.
So they're yours. Okay, so I think that's about it. On my social media, I was saying
Zeisterman.
Zeisterman, yeah, very good. So I think time for our social media. You'll have to say yours slowly, probably spell it out, because it got me confused.
Yeah, okay, so my social media, Instagram and Twitter, although I don't really use Twitter, is @Fietsman_SA. So it's just my name replaces Z with an F, which means bicycle man.
Or if you want to see it, just go on any of our pinned Instagram feed.
It'll be up there.
And it's on there anyway. And I just want to say quickly before we do this, talking about the Instagram feed, you brought this little gizmo here, which is it called the chain tamer,
yeah.
And I had a spare one which we put on my bike. Have a look on my Instagram pinned Instagram feed, have a look at that. I used it all day Sunday so far, because you've got to see how long the rubber's going to last.
Yeah,
very impressed.
Yeah, I got sent it to test it out, and yeah, I was a bit dubious, and I'm really impressed with it. Like,
and ignore the little rubber bits underneath mine, because it's actually not the right size for mine. They're going to send me the right size.
Yeah.
So that is, have a look at that. It's called the Chain Tamer. Check it out.
Yeah. Deadly silent chain is what we all want.
Yeah, it is. So I'm Jim Buchanan 955.
I'm Hughes 954.
And Doc.
I'm at DockerPod. Go check us out, guys.
And so, don't forget at Pin TV.
At Pin TV, you remembered. I always forget. Isn't it at Pin TV UK?
At Pin TV UK.
Yeah, at Pin TV.
We
both got there in the end.
I've got to say thanks to everyone.
Thanks to everyone in the audience.
Huge crowd in tonight.
Yeah, and thank you to Albert Shed in Shrewsbury. Please remember, you can come down here every Monday night, 7:30 to 8:30, and watch the show live. And there is always some goodies to be given away. And obviously, watch on YouTube. Please subscribe if you're watching and you're not subscribed. It helps us grow. And we'll see you next week.
Thanks for watching.
See you later.
Thanks for having me on the show.
Bye.
<Thank you. laughs>